Dr. Sangeetaji Reddy, President of FICCI, Mr. Uday Shankar, my friend, President-elect FICCI, and distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, good morning, Suprabhatam. It gives me great pleasure to interact with you all through this digital forum on the occasion of 93rd Annual Convention of FICCI. In more than 9 decades of its existence, FICCI has played a pivotal role in addressing the issues concerning Indian industry and business in the most constructive manner. It has played a very important role in India's emergence as one of the most rapidly growing global economies. Friends, the COVID-19 pandemic may have constrained our ability to meet in person. However, it has afforded us the flexibility of time, distance, and virtual interaction. Such a format facilitates a more inclusive dialogue with saving in time and resources. In that sense, this adaptation represents the very essence of converting challenges into opportunities, of transforming distance into proximity, and seeking inspiration from momentary setbacks. The pandemic is a massive challenge which has shaken up the whole world. It has impacted almost every aspect of our daily lives, and the setback to global economy is also immense. At the same time, the pandemic has also inspired and pushed the boundaries of the human ingenuity. My friends, I don't think there could have been a more apt theme for this year's convention. The beginning of the year 2020 was unfortunate for the entire world. The outbreak of coronavirus epidemic brought with it itself a great amount of uncertainty. India too was greatly impacted by it. It was a serious challenge for a nation like India that was making a quick stride towards attaining its right place in the comity of nations. Stopping, halting, or moving back was not an option for us, but human life was the most precious for us. The option was never between to save lives or to save livelihoods. We knew our utmost priority was first to save lives. We knew that at no cost we could risk the lives of millions. Hence, India became one of the first few nations to impose a countrywide lockdown that continued for weeks. We knew it is going to be hard, but we were certain that we would bounce back, and here what we call Inspired India played the most important role. The Inspired India that believes in our innate capacity to find opportunity among adversity. The Inspired India that was not ready to give up. The Inspired India that constituted of our medical fraternity who made every possible effort to minimize loss of lives. The Inspired India that constituted of you, the esteemed members of business and industry, who made every possible effort to minimize loss of livelihoods. My friends, the Inspired India that constitute of innovators and enterprising youth who work tirelessly to minimize loss of opportunities. The Inspired India constitutes of institutions like Election Commission that manage to conduct a free, fair and peaceful election with 7.79 crore voters in such a challenging time. The Inspired India that constitute of our armed forces whom no virus could deter from their duty. While the world was fighting the deadly virus, they were valiantly defending our borders. And above all, the Inspired India that constitute millions of common men and women who showed great patience and resilience in the this fight against coronavirus. Today, India is back on track with a new vigor in our fight against COVID-19 and inspired India with all Indians participated together as a nation. The role of citizens in successful implementation of the lockdown in order to contain the initial spread of the virus was no mean achievement. Voluntary organizations came forward to provide food, medicines, and essential supplies in lockdown. Civil society contributed by taking care of the needy, and the individuals stood by each other, many a time organizing tiffin services for migrants. It was amazing. The devotion of duty showed by our frontline COVID warriors, including doctors, healthcare workers, ASHA workers, sanitation staff, etc., earned the adoration of the entire nation. The government acknowledged this indomitable spirit of the entire nation. In order to pay respect and bind the entire nation with this spirit, innovative measures like clapping and beating thali, lighting of diyas, were encouraged by our Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi. Our defense forces also expressed their gratitude to coronavirus warriors, including healthcare workers, police, and forces who were at the forefront of the battle against the pandemic through flypasts, litter, ships, and musical tributes outside hospitals across the country. I still remember the time when serious doubts were raised regarding our ability to provide basic support facilities from masks to PPE kits, ventilators, and ICU beds. We have witnessed how different companies rose to the challenge to manufacture healthcare products like masks, PPE kits, sanitizers, ventilators, and ICU beds at the start of the pandemic. I congratulate our entrepreneurs who showed courage. They took a leap of faith in adopting and adjusting their production lines. That truly reflects the sentiment expressed by Gandhiji about companies acting as trusteeships, valuing social responsibility alongside profits. This pandemic has also proven that India has always been futuristic and has believed in finding permanent solutions to the problems. World over, there have been serious and sincere efforts to make a COVID-19 vaccine as early as possible. India too made a quick development in this regard. Today, after only 10 months, vaccines are in their final stage of development to be produced in India. But an important question was, what if tomorrow a new virus outbreak happens? Can we afford yet another coronavirus-like epidemic? The answer to this uncertainty is to create a defensive mechanism that can fight any virus. The answer is to strengthen our immune system. Friends, it is heartening to note that India has walked toe-to-toe with its global peers, helping people across the globe. Besides helping itself to recover from the crisis, this nation also helped many other countries of the world to recover. Whether it is evacuation, or supply of medicines, or any other kind of help, India is taking everyone along. That is, India has been inspired by itself and has also inspired others to help them get revived. There is a self-inspiration of India which has been embedded in us for centuries in the form of Sangachadvam, Sangvaradvam, that is, may we all go together, let us all move together. Friends, this government is action-driven and believes in tackling the problem head-on. Right from the start, our government has taken various steps to mitigate the adverse impacts of COVID-19 pandemic. The financial packages that the government has released have had wide-ranging and far-reaching impact. Commencing with the initiative on 26th March 2020, a Rs. 1.7 lakh crore package was announced, which focused on providing immediate relief to the poor, migrants, and both urban and rural workers also. It included food security and direct cash transfer. In May this year, a follow-up 20 lakh crore package addressed a number of challenges faced by the country. The focus of this initiative also aimed to provide a major impetus to the Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative. As you are aware, it included collateral free loans, relief for salaried taxpayers, workers, and other stressed businesses. Government contracts up to Rs. 200 crores were limited to only domestic firms. Nearly 81 lakh MSMEs have taken advantage of Prime Minister Narendra Modi's Emergency Credit Line Guarantee Scheme under the Atmanirbhar Bharat package. While special attention was given to MSME sector as they needed extra support, at the same time, several important policy decisions were also taken to incentivize big businesses. Soon after the nationwide lockdown, which ought to have a negative impact on the economy, the doom shares started making prophecies of doom. It was said that it would take more than 1 or 2 years for India to reverse the 23.9% contraction in our gross domestic product that we witnessed in the first quarter of this financial year. But once again, they were proved wrong. India bounced back in no time. In the second quarter, the Indian economy registered a 7.5% contraction in its gross domestic product, and it was a significant improvement over the 23.9% contraction that we witnessed in the first quarter. The manufacturing sector, which registered a 39.3% contraction in first quarter, registered a 0.6% growth in the second quarter. This forced the Asian Development Bank to change its forecast for the Indian economy, projecting 8% contraction in 2020 and 2021, as compared to 9% degrowth estimated earlier. Agriculture and allied sectors also grew. Electricity, gas, and other services posted at 4.4% growth as against a 7% contraction in previous quarter. This is a clear indication that India's economy is likely to return to pre-COVID-19 levels by the end of the current fiscal year, which is much earlier than expected. Friends, it is the strength of our economy only that India in April-August 2020 received the highest ever total foreign direct investment. The total FDI inflow in India in the first 5 months was $35.73 billion, 13% higher than that in the same period last fiscal. Our focus on infrastructure building and improvement has not diminished, and we see it is a great multiplier in terms of employment. You've heard here about the agricultural sector here, for it is the mother sector for all others. Agriculture has been one sector which has been able to avoid the adverse effects of the pandemic, and in fact, come out the best. Our produce and procurement have been plentiful, and our warehouses are full. There is no question of taking retrograde steps against our agricultural sector even. The recent reforms have been undertaken with the best interests of India's farmers in mind. We are, however, always misgivings, provide them with assurances we can provide. Our government is always open to discussion and dialogue. Or on the global front, friends, the undermining of global supply chains has created an opportunity to strike a balance between Atmanirbhar and globalization. I think the launch of Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan is a watershed moment in the economic history of India. Under the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan, several policy decisions have been taken that will provide new energy and enthusiasm to industry and business in the country. All of this has been made possible by the help of Inspired India, which is guided and motivated by the bold and decisive leadership of Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi, and timely policy interventions by the government. I firmly believe that in the time of crisis of this scale, it requires a rare leadership to bring people together. While our Prime Minister, not just like the head of the government, but like the head of the family, led the way for all of us. It was leaders from every field who too showed the way. Friends, today we are at the cusp of a major change. The post-corona world is not going to be same. The challenges are going to be big, and we will need grit and determination to deal with it. We will need the inspiration to deal with the new world order. We have to strike the right balance in our efforts to stimulate economic growth, prevent supply chain disruptions, and create new resilient supply chains. India is working with countries such as Japan and Australia in the context of resilient supply chains, especially in semiconductors, chips, and so on. India can be a great alternative to others because it offers a full spectrum of capabilities and opportunities to foreign investors and partners. India has the potential to emerge as a hub of manufacturing of healthcare products. Labor cost arbitrage is a dream that can still be chased by global manufacturing companies in India. We should catch the next wave for lowering global manufacturing costs. The Labor Code Bill 2020 is also our commitment to increase ease of doing business. I would urge the business community attending this seminar to look into the ways and means to ensure that India becomes a global manufacturer as soon. We need to take more fulsome advantage of the global shift in outsourcing of manufacturing to Asia. But to do this, we must scale up our skills as well. Among several sectors of the economy which are set to contribute towards our Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative and to the revival of growth, I believe the defense sector would play a significant role. Allow me to take this further and state in no uncertain terms that this is the approach we are trying to bring to the defense sector. It is not a very comforting fact that as one of the largest armed forces of the world, we are so import dependent in critical areas. While we have made some important strides in defense production, a lot more can and must be done. Unprovoked aggression on our Himalayan frontiers is a reminder of how the world is changing, how existing agreements are being challenged, how power is being asserted not just in Himalayas but across the Indo-Pacific, and how uncertain the future of the region and the world could be in this backdrop. As you are aware, there is a big build-up of armed forces at the LAC in Ladakh. In these testing times, our forces have shown exemplary courage and remarkable fortitude. They fought the PLA with utmost bravery and forced them to go back. The coming generations of this nation will be proud of what our forces have managed to achieve this year. Actually, certainly I am very proud of. Whenever there is a situation at the election, the most obvious outcome is a comparison between India and China's military strength. But I don't want to dwell on that. There can be a serious debate on who owns more military might, but when it comes to soft power, there is no scope of ambiguity. India is far ahead of China when it comes to leading the world with ideas. If you look at the entire East Asia from Burma to Thailand, to Indonesia, and Malaysia, even Japan, there is a huge Indian cultural impact on all these countries. Buddhism had a monumental influence over China to an extent that before the 1949 revolution, almost 80% of China's population followed Buddhism. I would like to quote the famous Chinese thinker Hu Xi, who had once the vice chancellor of the Peking University, and once he represented China in United Nations also. He rightly said, India has culturally, I would like to repeat it, India has culturally dominated and controlled China for more than 2,000 years without sending a single soldier across the border. This statement by Hu Xi underlines the fact that India as a civilizational state has been inspiring and influencing the world through its culture and soft power for centuries. Friends, India, due to its location, size, population, and economy, has always been at the strategic forefront of the global security. We have been victims of cross-border terrorism, yet have fought the scourge alone, even when there was no one to support us. But later, they understood we were right about Pakistan being the fountainhead of terrorism. And now, again, our brave forces are there in the forefront fighting icy winds to guard our borders and to fulfill their responsibility. The question is, can our industry also stand shoulder to shoulder with our forces? Can we use our economic strength to our advantage, forge the right partnership, bring the right technology for our armed forces? Can we be at the forefront of military production, lethal or non-lethal, like our soldiers on the border? Today, India is different from 1950s or 1960s. Our businesses, people like all of you, are champions in your sectors. You have the confidence that has come from great success in India and overseas, as well as the global reach to influence decisions. I urge you to please study our policy shifts in defense more carefully and organize your businesses accordingly. We have opened doors to the private sector, incentivized domestic production, are creating defense corridors and doing a lot more. We are also willing to engage in meaningful joint ventures and partnerships with other countries. We want to make defense equipment in India for the world. So, it is time industry examines this opportunity with both pride and priority. But I am here to also make another point. There comes a point in a nation's history, every now and then, when it needs to stand up for itself, tell that India can fight anyone, that it is capable to take any challenge just to survive. However, victorious is the country which not only rises to the challenge, but turns it into an opportunity, changes the way things are, and creates a new reality of prosperity, security, and peace. That's what we need to do in the defense sector. And that is also is the essence of Atmanirbharta. In other words, एक आत्मनिर्भर भारत से ही है सुरक्षित और समृद्ध भारत. डिफेंस है ह्यूज implications फॉर इंडिया's endeavors टू प्रमोट रिसर्च एंड डेवलपमेंट इनोवेशन एंड इट्स द फर्स्ट टू सिक्योर ए प्लेस इन द ग्लोबल सप्लाई चेन्स. अ पर्टिकुलर रेलेवेंस इज द फैक्ट दैट व्हाट एवर वी अचीव टुगेदर इन द डिफेंस सेक्टर हैज enormous spin-off benefits for the economy in general. Towards this objective, various initiatives have been taken in the defense sector recently. The newly introduced defense acquisition procedure 2020, along with our earlier decision to increase FDI in defense through the automatic route to 74%, will provide an impetus to domestic manufacturing and development with the induction of newer technologies and global best practices. A negative import list of 101 items has been released to give a boost to domestic manufacturing. This will especially provide an opportunity to the private sector to enter into the defense manufacturing space. Our Defense Production and Export Promotion Policy 2020 provides the necessary guidelines to provide an impetus to defense production and exports. I have no doubt that the private sector will remain an active participant in achieving the turnover of ₹1,75,000 crores and exports of ₹35,000 crores. We have not only renewed our forces, our focus on the research and development, but also made the facilities, labs, and patents of DRDO available for use in the private sector to encourage defense production. As part of our policy, there is special emphasis on supporting and encouraging MSMEs to become a part of global defense value chains. This means that they need support for upstream and downstream integration with raw material supply chains and markets. Their products need to be qualitatively competitive, not just in terms of price. Our industry associations have a big role and responsibility in this regard. My friends, for a large country like India, one of our primary objectives is to create employment for the 12 million people who enter the labor force every year. I want to use this platform and urge our luminaries of the corporate world to create more jobs for our youth to further their indomitable spirit. There is no doubt that together we will succeed in making not only a better India, but a better world. Let us join hands to work for a better future. Because this slogan, that Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, the whole world is a family, was given by India, not by any other country. At the end, I would like to congratulate Dr. Sangeeta Reddy. Again, at the end, I would like to congratulate Dr. Sangeeta Reddy, President of Federation of Indian Chamber of Commerce and Industries, and everyone associated with this esteemed organization for continuing with the rich tradition of holding this annual convention where thought leaders share their ideas and perspectives that help the government to form policies that are in the best interest of the industry.